morning, everyone. How are you? Thanks for catch. My name is Wayne Tufek. I'm the IT Security Risk Manager at the University of Melbourne. Today I'm going to outline, as Bikash said, a process that I've put together over the last 12 months. At the university, we've moved approximately 8 different types of applications and systems to the cloud. So I had to figure out some way in order to assess each of the vendors and determine whether they had the right controls in place and whether we could trust them. So this is the result of all of that. Some of it's been put together through quite a bit of trial and error. I made a few mistakes along the way. But what I think I put together is quite a robust process for assessing cloud vendors. So I'll talk a little bit about what is the cloud, what are the risks, outline the process, and then summarize. This presentation itself is longer than 10 minutes, so I'm going to move quite quickly through the slides. This particular presentation isn't necessarily about cloud computing, because I'm not going to speak anything in a great amount of detail about software as a service, platform as a service, infrastructure as a service, private clouds, public clouds, hybrid clouds, community clouds. You can find all that type of material on the internet quite easily. But what I will talk about, as I say, is a process for assessing third parties. So what is the cloud? This is the definition that I like to use: a scalable, multi-tenant, multi-platform, multi-network method of delivering information technology services. I'm speaking for my own experience at the university, but the cloud is very attractive for the business, from business purposes, for a number of reasons. You get access to the latest technologies. You can use a pay-as-you-go model. There's no upfront investment in hardware and software. There's rapid provisioning and deep provisioning. And on-demand scale is very easy. So what that translates to basically is a service that's very agile, and the business can move very quickly, resulting in faster time to market. And the fact that the business now doesn't need to concentrate on managing IT, they can simply concentrate on business and business innovation. So what are the risks? Essentially, the main risk from adopting a cloud service is that all your data is now being moved to a third party. It's now residing in a data set that you don't control, being managed by people that don't work for you anymore. So you're losing control over your data. So data may not remain in the same system, the same data center, or even within the same country. And your data will be stored, processed, and housed, possibly within systems where other customer data is also being stored. This all leads to the problem of risk transparency. What is that? Basically, it's a degree to which stakeholders have information that enables them to make a valid determination of risk. So you have no idea what controls this service provider has in place. So you can't make an accurate assessment as to whether you can trust them or not. And if we have a look at the different types of software offerings in the cloud, across the top, this is a diagram from Gartner. And have a look down at the various different types of IT services which make up the cloud service, such as network storage, server, possibly a hypervisor, an application, and a data database. As we move across the various different types of cloud services, we can see that responsibility for the different technical layers can be split between one or more parties. So having said that, we'll jump very quickly into the process. Just to understand who the players are in the process. You don't have the concept of a data owner within your organisation, you don't need one. Data owner is someone who's not from IT, but someone from the business. So for instance, at the university, our data owner for HR data is the executive director of HR, finance data is the CFO, etc, etc. This needs to be someone from the business. Of course, the IT department. The project team is handling the particular project or initiative to move the system to the cloud. Your legal department. Your vendor management section or department, if you have one, and the cloud service provider themselves. So this is the process in a nutshell. And we'll walk through each of these steps as we move through the presentation. But basically, confirm the data, engage with the owner, understand the business process. There are a few other considerations that are outlined, and then we assess the risk. So basically, we have a look at the different risk factors, move along, assess the risk, and make sure that we're still making a sensible decision in light of what we found at each stage. evaluate the cloud service provider, assess the risk, negotiate the contract, assess the risk, and then continually monitor and assess the risk. So let's start with the data. Identify who the cloud service provider is. As I said before, depending on which type of model the cloud service provider operates under, the various different technical layers may have more than one vendor who manages that environment. So understand whether the cloud service provider subcontracts anybody else in order to provide a service. Identify exactly what the data is. Now, this part is crucial. What I do at this stage is I put together a table down the field level of exactly what data is required. You don't want to work your way through the process, get to a point where you're about to sign a contract, and someone from the project tells you that whilst you thought it was data type A, it's actually data type B required as well. So you don't want any surprises at the end of the process. So determine exactly what the data is. Understand the business process, this is important. Understand what steps are being taken in the business process and why the business wants to do it and what they're trying to achieve. It is possible sometimes to change the business process. Perhaps not release important information. Engage with the data owner and perform a risk assessment. So, another graphic from Gartner. It's important to consider the business value of the process versus the importance of the information. So what that basically means is if the value of the information is high and the business process has a high value to the organization, then obviously think twice about moving into the cloud. There is obviously, if it's a low value business process and the value of the information is low, then it's a fairly easy decision to move to the cloud. What types of questions do you need to ask? Is the data going to the cloud? Is it business critical? Does the vendor have a business continuity plan? Will I maintain and keep a copy of the data? So, simply because the vendor is managing the data and doing backups, do you want to put another backup process in place where you actually take a daily copy of the information so that you have it on site? Do you have an in-house business continuity plan? What will happen if the cloud service is unavailable? How will you keep operating your business? What's the impact if the data is unavailable? And what's the impact if the data is made public? Often some other considerations which don't come out when you're working on a move to the cloud project is integrations with web services. So now it's no longer a simple matter of simply allowing systems within your own data center to interface, with a third party across the internet, possibly using something like a web service or some other integration. It's very important to consider this and map it out up front because these can introduce some cost and some risk. Support and maintenance processes. So if a user ends up with a query, who's going to perform the various levels of support, level 1, level 2, level 3? How will that work? Who's responsible for doing what? And then developing the test environment. If the development test environments are also being operated by the third party, how will you ensure that the non-production data is managed? So how critical is the data? Does it still make sense to move to the cloud after you've assessed all of these factors? Does the business process need to change? Assess the cloud service provider. There are many different ways of doing this. One, you can just accept what they're told you on face value. That's one option. Two, you can do some type of audit or bidding yourself. Or three, you can rely on the party assessment. We'll talk about a little bit about that later. Now, there's lots of good material on the internet. Some of it's free, some of it's not. I tend to use the Cloud Security Alliance information. They have a very comprehensive control framework, which is free. It outlines all the possible controls you can think of. It's also used by a lot of other organisations through the STAR, which is the Security Trust and Assurance Registry. So there are a lot of companies that have assessed themselves against the Cloud Security Alliance framework and documented their controls, as you can see. But there is other guidance from Defence Signals Directorate, which is the Australian version of the NSA. Common Assurance Maturity Model, Shared Assessments Program, the European Network Information Security Agency. If you Google those, then you'll find them quite easily. Essentially, what they all talk about is controls, things like security policies, change management processes, vulnerability scanning, logging and log retention, incident management procedures, patch management, business continuity, how customer segmentation is handled. There's actually another cloud framework that I came across from Microsoft called the Microsoft Cloud Decision Framework. when you're assessing this, the cloud service provider, one of the best ways of doing that is to have somebody else do it. There are, as you're all aware, standards which vendors can be assessed against, such as ISO 27001, PCI DSS, SSAE 16, SOC 1 and SOC 2. SOC 2 is the one that you're looking for. Also be aware that there are a number of security standards that are derived. So there's ISO 27017, which is Information Technology, Security Techniques, Security and Cloud Computing. And ISO 27018, which is Code of Practice for Data Protection Controls for Public Computing Services. So these standards are in draft and will take probably a few years before organisations begin being certified against them. Can you visit the cloud service provider yourself, ask questions, interview people, you can review the documentation that they have, conduct site visits. Always assess the risk after you assess the cloud service provider. When it comes time to look at the contract, there's a number of things that certainly we do in practice. Some are useful or more useful than others. What I do like to do is, if the vendor does give you any material, then you include that in the contract as a statement of what controls they have in place. Always include in the contract some regular formal third-party assessments to which you have access to them. So if they're audited regularly by internal audit or external audit, attempt to insert into the contract that those reports will be made available to you. Gartner has quite a lot of good papers available, which, if you have access to Gartner, prove quite useful. When you are looking at the contract, of course, the SLA is imperative or critical. Make sure that RTO and RPOs are defined and they meet your requirement. RTO is the recovery time objective, and RPO is the point objective. The time objective is how long it takes for data to be restored. The point objective is how much data you're able to lose. Always include their immediate notification of security breach. Make sure that when you're considering performance service levels, that uptime is always included. Make sure you include response time, very important. Make sure there are SLA penalties. Determine exactly when the downtime calculation starts. Ensure that the termination period is longer than 30 days. That doesn't give you enough time to move your data out without another cloud service provider, so make sure it's at least 12 months. Have a look at the liability limit. Often they try and limit the liability to 3 times the value of the contract, or 5 times, or some multiple, but that's nowhere near what the cost will be to your business if the system's unavailable or is a data breach. So I said before, make sure you include annual security certification and audit. Make sure you can get access to the reports. Once you negotiate the contract, come back and assess the risk. Does it still make sense? The last part of the process is ongoing monitoring. This is often best done by your vendor management function, whatever process they have for monitoring SLA. But you also play a part in assessing that risk if you've got access to third party reports. So there it is, a very quick overview of the process. I have used this, and I think if you do work through each of the steps, consider each of the risk factors, you do actually come out with quite a well-formed, well-made decision that you can actually speak to the data owner and explain to them what you've done, what controls you've looked at, and give them some assurance that a lot of the work that needs to be done is done, and they can feel secure in moving their information to the cloud. That's basically it. Thank you.